everyone, and welcome to a bonus screening of Movie Club. Now, this screening will happen on Christmas Eve because I decided I think I'll release 3 videos on the week of Christmas. And sure, that's a little bit weird, but whatever. I thought I'd do the weirdest possible Christmas movie I could right before we ended the series. Obviously, there'll be a palate cleanser tomorrow on Christmas Day with It's a Wonderful Life. And this one's a huge surprise. It was not announced previously, so Merry Christmas. It's a little bit of an early present that you can unwrap. Because tonight, we're watching through Stanley Kubrick's final film from 1999, Eyes Wide Shut. Now, you might be looking at me being like, Patrick, Eyes Wide Shut is not a Christmas movie. Well, I would say same argument as I made for Die Hard in a previous video. Yeah, it is. And largely, it's because the events of tonight's movie takes place all across Christmas Eve, and it's the juxtaposition with this holiday that has both religious undertones, kind of a moral backbone, or at least there's a lot of morality kind of built into the Christmas season. And to juxtapose the events of this film with that gives us a delightfully different type of film. Now, Kubrick was never known for playing it safe. He did a ridiculous amount of movies during his admittedly not very populated career. His filmography is pretty easy to watch through in like 2-3 days. And that's sadly because we didn't get a ton of movies from Kubrick while he was with us. But the movies he did leave with us, I mean, he had a string of incredible films. Some of my favorite movies are made by Kubrick, including The Shining, which we've already covered on this series, and Barry Lyndon. Also, of course, the other film we've covered from Kubrick on this series, Dr. Strangelove. This man was great at dark comedy at the same time as he was creating these really intense atmospheres, and he used that talent to great effect throughout his career. Kubrick's favorite film of his was this one. And actually, Kubrick turned in the final cut to Warner Brothers of this film just a few short days before he passed away, which means he never got to see the reception of this film or its critical understanding, and to me that's really, really sad, because this might be one of his best films. And once you see this, you might think I'm a weirdo for thinking that, but it's because I think there's a lot more going on in this film than it seems at first blush, which, if you've seen a Kubrick film before, that's always the case. Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman star as married couple the Harfords, and very quickly in this film, their relationship has a devolution, or at least a major change, when Alice Harford, played by Nicole Kidman, admits to Tom Cruise's William Harford that she once, briefly, dreamed about having an affair with some man she saw in a hotel.
He glanced at me as he walked past, just a glance. Nothing more. But I could hardly move.
This sends Tom Cruise and, by extent, William Harford on a dark night of the soul, where he continuously puts himself in situations where he can cheat on his wife. So obviously this film is a meditation on marriage, sexuality, and so much more, because this film has a ginormous famous scene regarding a sex cult. Yeah, this film's weird. But I never pretended it wasn't. Part of the draw for doing this as part of the Christmas series for me was that it was so bonkers and weird to do this, but it's also just a really good and well-made movie. If you're a fan of David Fincher's work and his perfectionist streak of creating these immaculate framings and these brilliant fluid shots, effectively, everything Fincher learned was from probably watching Kubrick's films. Because that perfectionist streak is all over Kubrick's work. And nowhere is that more apparent than some of the earliest shots in this film, as well as that big scene that everyone talks about, but no one wants to talk about. once again, very early on, you'll notice that Kubrick doesn't do typical scores for his movies. Ironically, more often than not, he asks a composer to make a score and then ends up deciding on some classical pieces. And let's just say the juxtaposition between what's supposed to be high society and what eventually we get to see as their deep, dark secrets, the juxtaposition between those two things is really interesting, and I kind of love it as a aesthetic decision. Another weird thing is that Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman were actually married during the production of this film. And if this film wasn't at least a tiny factor in what eventually caused them to get divorced, you know, besides Tom Cruise also being a part of a cult, yeah, I said it, I would be genuinely surprised. Because, you know, working on a Kubrick movie is stressful, and this film had a notoriously long production schedule. And when I say it's a notoriously long production schedule, this film was actually in the Guinness Book of World Records for the longest film shoot at 400 days. That's insane. And no film has really come close to ever unseating this. And pretty much, I don't think a single other director besides Kubrick could have gotten away with this. The final result, I would argue, is 100% worth it. One of the things I do love about this movie's trailer, which no doubt you've probably watched in preparation for this screening, is that it doesn't tell you literally anything.
So you get nothing! You lose! Good day, sir!
It gives you a couple shots of the action, but not really a through line to connect everything together. And to be fair, this is really just a very meditative movie, and especially at its runtime of 2.5 hours, you're gonna have plenty of time to think about not only what you would do in the character's shoes, but to think about your own morality and your code and your ethics and juxtapose that against the holiday season. It's kind of brilliant because of that. One of my favorite scenes in this movie, especially when it comes to acting, is Nicole Kidman's performance when she reveals her deep, dark secret of once, at least in her mind, thinking about having an affair at a hotel. The long shots of Cruise reacting to this news and the way that Nicole Kidman tells this story is so brilliantly and gorgeously captured by cinematographer Larry Smith. It's just one of the best acted scenes in the entire movie, in a movie full of great performances. I don't want to spoil what happens later in the film because this is bonkers, but I do genuinely love this movie. One of the more interesting bits of trivia about this movie is that in this film's most infamous scene, computer-generated people are put in the foreground to obscure some of the more obscene acts happening in the background. And this is done to keep the MPAA off of Stanley Kubrick and for the movie to actually be granted the R rating that Kubrick desired. Because as I've mentioned before, the NC-17 rating is a death sentence for most movies. If you want a wide release, you can't get an NC-17, and prior to that, you couldn't get an X. These ratings effectively demolish any chances of being seen anywhere outside of art houses, and it's just not a great financial choice. So sometimes that puts you at the beck and call, the will of whatever group of people make up the MPAA today, because it's a revolving door of people who come in and you never know who they are and you never know how puritanical they're going to be. With films like this, you really have to play it safe, and the CG people in this particular scene help Kubrick get away with some of the stuff that is in this movie. While Nicole Kidman has cited her experience on this film as being fantastic and akin to attending film school, Tom Cruise didn't exactly love playing his role, but has been quoted as saying that he would have kicked himself had he not done this movie. Here, and I'm going to have to reference my notes because this is a book that's in a different language, and I apologize for that, and I don't want to butcher the name, but I still will, I promise. It's based on the novella Traum Nouvelle by Arthur Schnitzler, but it contains a lot of the same seedy elements that eventually made it into Kubrick's film. While Kubrick himself was not really a religious man, it could easily be argued that pretty much every one of his films that he had major creative control over is dealing with, or at least tangling up with the ideas of faith and religion, because those kinds of things, especially like morality and those codes, come from somewhere, and Kubrick was always fascinated by that. So it makes a ton of sense that Kubrick would love this final work of his and consider it his best work ever. And while we're still appraising it all these years later, you know, 21 years on, it could easily be argued that he was probably right. This film has some of his most fascinating imagery and definitely probes a lot of deep, dark questions that most people would be uncomfortable to touch with a 10-foot pole. But here, Kubrick does it for over 2.5 hours. And if nothing else, that's commendable. And it's even more commendable because he made a great film while asking these questions. And so, I guess I'll just close with not much more explanation about what you're about to get into, and just say, 'tis the damn season. So sit back. You're probably not going to be able to relax while you watch this, but that's the line. Sit back, relax, and enjoy as much as you can. The final film from Stanley Kubrick, 1999's Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman starring Eyes Wide Shut. We'll be right back.